Hello, everyone, and welcome to CASI, the Center for the Advanced Study of India at the University of Pennsylvania. My name is Tarek Tuchel, and I'm the director of CASI. I'm delighted to be able to host this special event, not our normal Thursday seminar, but a special event on the Deoliwallahs, a virtual book talk with the authors Dilip and Joy Ma, whose recently released book is the subject of today's presentation. I'm not going to take too long because I want to introduce our moderator who will introduce both the authors and moderate the session, Swagato Ganguly. And so before turning it over to him, let me just briefly introduce all of you to him. Swagato has been the editorial page editor of the Times of India from 2009 to 2021. He's currently a consulting editor there. He actually obtained his PhD in comparative literature and literary theory right here at UPenn in 1998, and has worked since then on editorial pages of a number of Indian newspapers, commenting on national politics and international affairs. He currently also holds an affiliation as a research affiliate in the Lakshmi Mittal South Asia Institute at Harvard. And his contemporary research interests lie in strategic affairs, geopolitics of the Indo-Pacific region, and Indian foreign policy more generally. His two most recent books are Idolatry and the Colonial Ideas of India, Visions of Horror, Allegories of Enlightenment, which was published by Routledge in 2018. And then he edited Destined to Fight, India and Pakistan, 1990 to 2017, which was published by Times Group's Books in 2017. He's actually going to be a visiting fellow here at CASI. He's scheduled to arrive in just about 2 weeks. We're delighted to be able to host him for a few months here in Philadelphia. And while he's here, he's going to be researching the timely subject of the geopolitical triangle between India, China, and the United States in the Indo-Pacific region. We're delighted he's a perfect person to moderate this discussion, and we're delighted that he's able to do so. Before I turn it over to him, just to let you know what the format is going to be, Swagato will introduce our authors and they will talk about their project for about the first 35, 40 minutes of our session together. And then we'll open it up to Q&A, which Swagato will moderate. Please enter all your questions in the chat feature. You can just enter them to everyone in the chat feature and in the chat box. And Swagato will pick up your questions and get to as many of them as possible. That'll take us through the hour. So thank you once again, everyone, for joining us. And Swagato, over to you. And thanks again to Dilip and Joy as well.
Thank you, Tarek. Welcome Joy Ma and Dilip D'Souza. Joy Ma grew up and was educated in India until she left for graduate school in the US. She now lives in the San Francisco Bay Area. Dilip D'Souza was once a computer scientist, and then he moved to writing and journalism. He writes now about political and social issues, travel, sports, and mathematics. His writing has won him several awards, including the Statesman Rural Reporting Award, the Outlook Picador Indian Nonfiction Prize, and the Newsweek Daily Beast South Asia Commentary Prize. Joy and Dilip have co-authored the Deoliwallahs, which is an untold story from India's post-independence history that's very movingly and beautifully narrated. It also has many echoes in the world today, where the tensions between ethnic and civic nationalisms have once again come into play and have been foregrounded in India and many other parts of the world as well. The theme of the book is foreshadowed very well in the preface, where Dilip writes about being on a bus on a Canadian highway about 5 years back, and he's with a group of former inmates. I'm sorry, I should have said that the book is about the internment of about 3,000 Chinese Indians at a prisoner of war camp, at a former prisoner of war, World War II era prisoner of war camp at Deoli in the state of Rajasthan, soon after the 1962 India-China war. And so the book begins with Dilip talking about, writing about how he's returning with a group of former inmates of Deoli on a Canadian highway. They've just been to a demonstration in front of the Indian High Commission in Ottawa, where they're asking that their experience be acknowledged. And while they're returning, but I think Dilip can tell the story better about a certain event that happened, which perhaps belied your expectations while you were coming back on the bus.
You want me to tell the story, Swagato, is that right?
Ying Sheng Wang, yeah. Why don't you tell it? I think you can tell it better.
Okay. Let me also say before I start, thank you so much to CASI and to Tariq and to all of you for tuning in here. This is Joy and I are truly grateful for the chance to talk about our book every time we get, and this is an honor really to be a part of UPenn and doing this. So this story that you're talking about, Swagato, is when in 2017, in August of 2017. People, about 50 Chinese Indians who are settled in Toronto, decided that they would like to make this representation to the Indian High Commission in Ottawa and hand over a letter saying, addressed to Prime Minister Modi, saying that we would like you to consider an apology for what happened to us in 1962. So when I heard that they were going to do this and that they were going to take a bus from Toronto to Ottawa and hand over this, I decided I needed to be on that bus. So I took a flight from here in Bombay and went to Toronto, and I joined these people on the bus. And what you're talking about is the way I begin the book, which really was an eye-opener for me in a lot of ways, my reaction to this. Because here were all these people who, for better or worse, looked Chinese sitting around me in this bus. And one of them, Ying Sheng Wang, who is known to all as Bobby Wong, whom I hadn't met, but I knew of him because I'd seen him in a film that we talk about and so on. Anyway, so there he was, and he's chatting to us, all of us, mostly in Hindi. And then people say, Bobby, come on, sing a song for us. And I thought, well, you know, here's this Chinese looking man, he's going to sing a Chinese song. But he breaks out into Ajeeb Dasta Hai Ye, Ajeeb Dasta Hai Ye, Kaha shuru kaha khatam. You know that song, and most Indians will know that song. It's an old Hindi song. And here was this man who's emigrated from India probably 30 or 40 years ago. He's gone through the experience in this camp. You know, he's been in a sense betrayed by India, and he's living in Canada. And what does he sing? He sings an old Hindi song. And to me, you know, it not only opened my eyes about what was I doing thinking this guy is Chinese, but also opened my eyes about what India meant to him and to so many people like him. So that's my story.
So I think one often presumes what the cultural affinities of a person or even the political affinities of a person are by the way the person looks, but that can be very deceptive. In reality, the Chinese Indian community has deep roots in India, particularly in eastern India, in Bengal and Assam, which goes back for quite long. And in Kolkata or Calcutta, I think it's better to say Calcutta because it was known as Calcutta during the events that are described in the book. Calcutta, where both Joy and I grew up, was a very cosmopolitan city. It has cosmopolitan origins in the sense that it was set up by the English in the 18th century as a free trading port, which attracted people really from all over the world, including from China, going way back to the 18th century. And since then, people have settled down in India, but they've integrated into Indian lifestyles and in the places where they live. So when I was growing up in Calcutta as a middle-class Bengali, a typical middle-class Bengali boy, perhaps, I was very aware of the Chinese community there. We often used to go to restaurants in the Chinese part of town, and there used to be a particular smell there, which Joy describes in the book, and which I also remember, which is, you know, the smell of tan leather, and animal hides, because the leather tanning industry in the city was often in the hands of the Chinese community. And so if we needed to buy a shoe or a shoe fixed, it wasn't like today when you would go to a mall and pick up a shoe and then throw it away after use. We would usually go to a shop. There was a Chinese Indian shop to get it fixed, to buy a new shoe or to get it fixed if it got worn out. The point of this long preamble is that although I was very aware of the Chinese community in Calcutta, I had no notion whatsoever about the Deoli story, or the story of the internment of close to 3,000 Chinese Indians, till I read this book. So this book was quite a revelation. So to begin with, Joy and Dilip, could you tell us something about the history and long-term presence of the Chinese community in Eastern India, which perhaps not everyone in the audience is fully cognizant of?
Sure, I could start. I can start from my family's perspective, and then actually in the audience, sometimes there are people from Assam. So my family, my grand uncle, he came as the first person to India, and he went and apprenticed in Assam, where the tea industry was more established. And as you know, tea came from China. It's a fascinating story of how the British East India Company and the government sought to break the monopoly of China on the production of tea and looked to their colonies to produce tea. So saplings of tea were smuggled out of China, and then they tried it in Assam, they tried it in different areas, and of course Sri Lanka too. And so my grand uncle had come out from China, and at that time Assam was the most, as I mentioned, most established tea estates were there. And so he learned the tea industry, and actually we're not tea growers, but what our family is are builders. And so there was definitely a demand for the factories, building of structures. And so that's an area they got into, and they were general contractors, and they were also sourcing the carpenters who came from their village and around their village to come and build. And so over the years, he moved from Assam to what is known as Alipur Duar. And so that's the area near Siliguri. And the town where we were established was called Hashimara. And so we got he built a company with his brothers that was called Macha Brothers. And they were very successful in that area. And all the tea plantations would contract with them. So they would actually support the tea garden with a master carpenter in residence. And so that person would stay in the factory, stay in the tea plantation, and fix things as needed. And if they needed more help, then my grandfather, who inherited the company, would send people. So that was the story of my family. They were in the sort of like in what was termed countryside. But then there was a whole migration of people to the city, because there's more opportunity, there's more community. And so the community in Calcutta actually grew to be very robust and very, very, very busy, you know, with the community. I think the Chinese established themselves as having good restaurants, having like good salons, having good dry cleaning, and those were the niches they filled. And I just wanted to address something that you had mentioned, Swagato, that there was one Chinatown that was the Tangra area, right? But then there was another one that was actually Calcutta city proper. It was less known. It was Tereti Bazaar or Tereta Bazaar. And so over there, we would have like a morning event, right? So there was a parking lot, and in the morning before the cars came in with the people who started work at 9, from 7 to 9, there would be a breakfast bazaar. And so first it started with just a few Chinese items, and then over time it expanded to having like all sorts of vendors there. And they just cleaned up at 9 and they disappeared. I think they might still have it, I'm not sure. But that just gives you a sense of the robustness. And then of course, you know, since Assam was such a booming tea garden, a lot of Chinese settled in Makkam, a little bit in Dibrugarh, Tinsukia, and Dilip writes about that a fair amount. And there's still like relics of the Chinese community there. I think it's more blended right now. But yeah, that's my piece. Dilip, you can talk about that.
Yeah, can I just say something about that? This word relic that Joy used, and that truly is, and what I love to point out to people when I talk about this is that you can get onto Google Maps and look at a map of Tinsukia or of Makkum, which is a little further east, which was actually the last town from which people were brought to Deoli. But you can look at Google Maps now and you'll still find a neighborhood or streets called Chinapati, which is a reference to the Chinese being in that area, you know, all those years ago, and that the Chinese neighborhood really that was in those towns of ethnic Chinese who were in those areas. And to think that it's still called Chinapati today. And when I was in Tinsukia, once or twice people, when I was asking them for directions, I was told, you know, go to Chinapati and you'll find the restaurant or whatever you're looking for. So that's really like a relic of, that's a good word for the Chinese presence in those towns.
And Calcutta is perhaps one of the few cities where if you get into a cab and say, I want to go to Chinatown, the cab driver will ask you which Chinatown, you know, and then you have to specify Tangra, Tereta Bazaar or whatever. Joy, could you tell us something about what happened during or soon after the 1962 India-China war when armed policemen might come knocking at doors of Chinese Indian families and, you know, take people away, sometimes giving very little time for preparation or to pack some belongings. Was there some kind of prior notice that, you know, something like this could happen, or and were all members of families taken away, or just some members of families taken away? How did it happen?
Yeah, so it's a bit varied. So for Ying Marsh, I write about her in the book. Her father was actually taken a month before before the general internment. So he was taken, this was in Darjeeling. So he was taken and then he was kept in Darjeeling jail. And then a month later, they came to collect her brother and her grandma. And then they didn't reunite until they went to the they reunited in jail. For the others, these were boys in boarding schools. It was different. So there was Andy Shea, who was in a boarding school, and he was just called at breakfast by the prefect or the headmaster and said, oh, can you come to my my office? And when he went to the office, he saw the police officers, and the police officers said, oh, you know, just gather your stuff. Should be a couple of weeks. And so he actually even took his football, right? Because he was playing football. And then, so really cascades. So the next person is Ying Sheng Wong and Bobby Wong. And he heard about these boys being rounded up and taken in Shillong, and their family was the next. And Michael, who's here, Michael Chang, his family also became at night and just asked them to pack up. There was very little information given. You know, it was very vague about where they were going, how long it would be. And so a lot of people, not even the people in the book, but the people who were caught first, right? So in my family situation, the carpenters and the workers got taken first, and they were taken without their wives. It was very, very quite random. It depended on who was, so communications, I think, were not very coordinated. So in our situation, only the men were taken because they had Chinese passports, right? And then in other areas, like in Assam, the whole family went if there was they were given an option. And so so when you ask about it, the general internment started in November 17, 1963. It was a day after the war officially ended. But it was different depending on who was doing the taking. And so likewise, when they landed in the camp, it was also very disorganized because I don't think, you know, from what I hear, like the first people who were taken, they were just taken, as I mentioned, and they didn't have anything. And so even when they were being given food, they had no utensils because the camp didn't have any utensils to give. And so you're talking about like, what do you keep dal in, right? It's like a soupy kind of stew. They were literally using whatever they had, like caps, and it was really awful those first days. But the thing I want to bring up is also the lack of communication. I mean, back in those days, you know, you didn't have a lot of communication, but like the fact that they were bringing a whole bunch of Chinese into the camp, people didn't understand that these were actually people who were born in India, could speak Hindi, and, you know, were like really quite entrenched in life in India. And so the officials were shocked that they could talk in Hindi. And so, of course, there was some education going on. It was like, you know, we were here, we were born. And so the camp was really unprepared for it. So that sort of paints a picture of, you know, what it's a small segment of what happened, but all the people who were in the book gives you some idea of how, you know, in the middle of the night, there's a knock at the door, very little prep, and then you're just taken after several days, waiting for more people to be collected, put on a train that was had the words enemy written outside of it.
And you were actually born in the camp. So did conditions improve at the camp later, you know, after was there a sort of period of initial absolute chaos, but things improved a little bit later? And you know what happened to things like healthcare? If people fell sick, were there doctors, and also education of young people, which was obviously disrupted by the camp experience for young people of a certain age. So how did young people spend their time? You know. Were there any sports facilities or the kinds of things people do at the camp?
Right. So no, there was no activities, no organizations of any sort to support young children. So Andy, at some point, he became a tutor. There were self-appointed tutors. There was this guy, in our opinion, in our circles, who was called Guru, and he was just a do-it-yourself kind of person, and he taught people very practical things. There was a tutor, and I think Michael talks about it, and after a while, like, the guy didn't have any books, so he was teaching the same thing over and over again, and you're talking about years for these children, and there was a lot of boredom. You know, when you read the book, you get a sense of how isolated and how bored these kids were, especially for the teenagers. It was a very disruptive kind of time. Some were ripped out from schools, and most of the people never went back to school again because it was such a gap. You know, you can imagine your own children if they missed like a 2-3 weeks. You're already panicking about school. We talk about years. And when they went back to school, they were much older than everybody else. And so it was really, really a terrible loss in years for all the children and the teenagers who went in. As far as the conditions of the camp, in the beginning, it was utterly kind of chaos. They had like these group cooking, group cooking activities, or I'm not getting the word, but basically they would say, okay, this group, you're in, you know, barrack, whatever, it's about 5-6 families, you're gonna take all these supplies and you're gonna cook. And cooking for a lot of people is really difficult. You know, you can barely cook rice for yourself, that doesn't get burned. And so, and then, you know, they had to cook in the open fire. It was awful, because not only was it difficult for people cooking it, so they took turns, right? And so just from a practical point of view, the fire was not controlled. And so when the food was bad, you know, and it was served to everybody else, already all these people who were so so sad and isolated, they really got very angry, you know, when the rice was burned or uncooked or the vegetables burned, which would have happened. You know, you're talking about roaring fire, you know, can barely cook on it. So it created a lot of misery for the folks who were, you know, and dread, you know, when it came to your turn to cook, it was just a nightmare. And so my mother was lucky. She actually went to, she was able to find a connection who had a cook. And so she would pay the cook through her rations, you know, so everybody got like 5 rupees a month or something. And so she would use these coupons to pay him, and he was able to cook, clearly, because he could do it. Then from that point, they decided, you know, that was a bad idea. After the camp representatives from the Chinese community communicated this, then they broke it down to everybody would, you know, get their own rations. And then like at 9 o'clock every day, you would go to the gate of the camp and collect your food and come back. And so that got a little bit better. But besides that, there was a movie perhaps once a week, but there were no other activities that I heard.
Since you talk about the situation in the camp, Swagato, can I just read a small part from the book, a few paras that addresses
certainly
that?
Yes.
So, you know, then Home Minister Lal Bahadur Shastri actually visited the camp in 1963 at some point, and then went back to Delhi after meeting all the people in the camp. And from other stories I've heard that, you know, the people in the camp surrounded him and asked him to, you know, when are we going to get released, and, you know, please improve conditions, whatever. So anyway, he went back to Delhi and he went back to Parliament. And here's just 3 paragraphs from the book. In August that year, there was a discussion about the internees in the Rajya Sabha. J.S. Pillai, Member of Parliament, asked how many internees at the Deoli camp had, quote, refused to go to China. The Minister of State for Home Affairs, that's Lal Bahadur's deputy, R.M. Hajar Navis, told him 595. So were they prepared to go to Formosa, Pillai asked. No, they want to remain in this country, he was told. How many detainees were there in the camp, Pillai asked. So the total comes to 2249. Then N. Sri Ramareddy, MP, asked about these 595. Were they refusing to go to China because that country's government has been following international perfidy and all that sort of thing? This is a direct quote, by the way. Lal Bahadur Shastri answered, saying he had not discussed exactly this question with the prisoners, but he had inferred that the present policy of the Chinese government is not acceptable to them, and that they were happy to remain in India, which was a free country and had a democratic setup. Now, Shastri, you must remember, just returned from the camp. So he told the Rajya Sabha that the internees he met there were, quote, exceedingly happy. Especially, I found the women and children fully satisfied with the arrangements made and the facilities provided in the camp. I really want to put that out, that phrase, exceedingly happy. Our then Home Minister, who then became Prime Minister of this country, told the Rajya Sabha that these prisoners, like Joy's family, were exceedingly happy in that camp. I really want to know what that means.
So I have to give, so thank you, Dilip, for bringing that up, because I'd like to share what happened in the camp. For the people who actually went to see Lal Bahadur Shastri's talk. And so at one point, you know, they were really excited he was coming. And so they went, and my parents went too. And so he said, this was a group who maybe before the last ship, or I think that's when it was timed. And he said, okay, those of you who want to live in India, you know, you can return to home. Those who want to go, you're free to go, free country. And so he said, those people who want to stay, you come to this side, and those people who don't want to stay, you go that side. And so everybody sort of, you know, sorted themselves out. And so my parents went to the live in India side, because dad was born in India, mom was born in India, that was where their home was. And so so they chose it because they were promised that they could return home. That was the most important thing to them. And clearly, as you know, that never happened. And so my mom actually had no idea that Lal Bahadur Shastri had eventually become the Prime Minister of India. And so, you know, I mentioned Prime Minister at one point, and she's like, no, Home Minister. And we had an argument about it. And then I realized that, you know, she just never knew. And, you know, it took her aback a little bit. She was taken aback, and we paused. And so that was just a terrible realization for me that, you know, that's like a really, that's pure evidence of, you know, losing all your time. So that was what transpired in the camp. And interesting to see what was reported in Rajya Sabha.
So that's a deception. That's what politicians typically do. But some people actually went to China, I believe, on ships. And I think that was actually a very terrible time to go to China, because it was the, you know, the great leap forward, and people were dying of starvation in China. And but what was the, you know, people underwent varying durations of incarceration. Some people were let off after 1 year. The maximum period seems to be about 5 years of incarceration. And Joy, your family was actually one of the worst afflicted. I mean, family stayed for 5 years in the camp. Yeah. And some people went to China. So, was it that just some people lined up, you know, when Lal Bahadur Shastri came and said, we want to go to China, and they were deported, and the rest. But even among the rest, there were sort of varying degrees of incarceration, you know. So what decided that, on based on what principle?
I really don't know. All I can say is, you know, I think there were three ships that came, three batches of people who returned to China, who went to China, I should say, because a lot of them were born in India. That decision had been made before Shastri came to the camp. And I don't know what the policies really are. You know, we don't have access to that kind of information of what they, how they decided to let people out. So don't know.
Yeah, but the only thing to add to that, Swagato, is that, you know, at least my hackles rise when we say things like they were repatriated or they were returned to China, because they had nothing to do with China. Most of these people, they grew up in India, they had roots in India, they spoke only Assamese and Hindi and so on. And for us to then say that, you know, these people wanted to go to China, or they went off, they were repatriated to their home country, that's nonsense. Their home country was this country, you know, and it's this country that should have taken them back home to their real homes. I just wanted to put that out.
But as opposed to state actions, there were occasions which you write about the in the book. There were occasions when ordinary Indians showed a great amount of humanity. You know, there was these doctors, Lohit Konwar was one of them, who were on the train to Deoli looking after sick people. There was an Assamese novel that was written about the plight of the Chinese internees, Chinese Indian internees. Could you talk a little bit about that, perhaps?
Okay, so Lohit Konwar is a guy, is a doctor I met in Tinsukia, and there's a connection to the novel. There's a novel written by this well-known Assamese novelist called Rita Chaudhary, called Makum. It was called Makum in Assamese, which is the Assamese name for Makam, Makam, which is the Assamese name for Makum, which is the town. And so she wrote this novel about this story. And it came out in about 2010, 2011. So around that time, I met Lohit Konwar. He was still a practicing doctor. And he told us the story about how he had been asked at the time of this incarceration. You know, he was just told, he was a young doctor, fresh out of medical school. And he was told, there's this train going and there are going to be a lot of people in it. And they need some doctor medical attention. I mean, they may need. So we need a team of doctors to go with the train. So he gets on this train and with a few other doctors, and they go for 6 days traveling west to Deoli. And he just happens to notice that most of these people are Chinese looking, or all of them, in fact. But he also notices, and he tells me, that most of them are wearing this Assamese, the women at least were wearing this Assamese outfit called a Mekhla Chador. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. And then he goes there. Maybe there were a few colds and things that he attended to on the way. And then he spends a day or two there, and then he gets on a train again and comes back, and that's the end. He's forgotten about that story till many years later. And when he's telling me all this, he says, this is what shows that we are different from those Nazis in Germany. You know, we Indians have humanity because we put doctors on that train. So, I put that in the book just without comment, because I would like our readers to judge for themselves whether that really shows humanity. But apart from that, what was really struck me, and that's a connection to this novel, is because his son then, the old man got tired and he went away, and his son was talking to me and he said, we only found out last year about this, about my father's experience, 50 years later. So I said, well, but why? Why didn't he ever tell you? And what happened last year? He says, well, this book got published. And he read the book. And then he came to us one day and said, the stuff that she's writing about, it's not just fiction. It's not just a novel. And so the son said, but why? How do you know? And he says, well, I was on that train that she writes about. And that's the thing that really struck me. That really captured for me, in a sense, this whole amnesia that we're talking about. Here was this guy who was on the train but had forgotten about it, in a sense, for 50 years.
Right. To be fair, the reference point is not really concentration camps like the for Deoli, Deoli wasn't Auschwitz or Gulag. The reference point would more be, the Japanese internment of Japanese in America during World War II. That is sort of memorialized much more, right? I mean, the people sort of memorialized.
Is it a consolation, Swagato? To me, it really isn't.
No, it's just an accurate description. I know it's not a
right,
sort
no,
of.
I'm saying yes. We didn't have gas chambers, and it wasn't a concentration camp like the Nazis had. But the fact that you these 3,000 people and took them away against their will. That's a shameful episode in itself.
Absolutely.
Yes, and I think I want to add this point that we don't have anybody really saying this, but it seemed to me like the internment at Deoli was about 20 years after the Japanese internment, so it seemed like a playbook that somebody had picked up and said, okay, we can do this, but they didn't follow through on all the rest of the, I'll put it in quotes, the benefits or whatever activities that the Japanese Americans got, which they had some education, they had, they had schools. None of that was also brought in. And I'm not, not editorializing this, but just just wanted to add that.
Actually, I had a slightly different question, which is why I brought that in, which is that the Japanese American experience is a lot talked about, but the Deoli experience is hardly known about, which is and it is only very recently that people have started talking about it. So that is what I really wanted to bring up. So clearly there was a lot of stigma around the experience, which, you know, took a lot of time to overcome.
It is stigma is one word. A lot of the people, Joy will corroborate me in this and explain a little further. They just felt, ashamed or hesitant to talk about this for many years. But for me, I'm not Chinese Indian. What really gets me is how did all of us forget about it? We were not part of this camp. This whole thing happened, but yet 50 years later, 60 years later, we have no. Most Indians don't even know this happened. How did that come about? Joy, do you want to talk about the reticence or the stigma in among the Chinese Indian community?
Sure. So for the kids, the teenagers who are going in, the question that keeps coming up, like this is decades later, they ask, what did we do wrong? Why were we treated as criminals? So the stigma is real and true. The fact that everybody forgot about it and didn't come to their aid, there was no international outcry that, there was an internment of any sort. It was very quiet, it was swept under the rug. And so there's a lot of simmering questions and anger and doubts and, a lot of the people who were in the camp eventually immigrated when they could. And it wasn't a pleasant thing to talk about. So there's actually one person who didn't talk about it for 40 years. He went to work, never talked about it. And then when he went back to India, so this is Stephen Wong, when he went back to India, it was such an emotional moment. It really came out. He wanted to touch and feel all the things he had left behind. So I would say it's not pleasant. You need to find community. And so some of the boys who were in the camp, they remained lifelong friends. And so when Bobby, Yingcheng Wong, went to Toronto, over time after he had settled his family, he was able to think about this organization. It's the AIDCI, and it provides support and community for the people who were interned. It's based in Toronto, and they do a fair amount of work with keeping the community together and also taking certain actions, writing letters to the Indian government, to the prime minister, and so on. And so so it took a lot of time to overcome the shadow of the camp. In fact, if you read the book, Eva Cheng, she's the second generation. She never went to the camp, but her dad did, Michael, went to camp. And that just cascades down to the future generation. So the effects of camp is a presence. Like for me, it was always a presence. I was born there. And my mom would say, on my birthday, she would say, I went to the hospital at 10:30 at night alone. Dad wasn't allowed to go with her. So from the gate on, she had to walk to the hospital on her own and, deliver really quickly. And so, the camp is a presence for all of us. It doesn't overwhelm us. I think a lot of people have, resolved that issue, but we've decided that it's not to be forgotten. And that's why it gives us some, something to work towards. That's important.
After going through this terrible experience, of incarceration, it wasn't as if that when people got released from the camp, it was a release from their troubles, because a lot of people lost their property, lost their livelihoods. That many of them were not allowed to go back to their hometowns or their original places. They were just dumped in Calcutta, many of them, sometimes without any money. Joy, your family had a particularly harrowing experience in that regard. But it's also inspiring in some sense, in terms of how your mother dealt with what happened. Perhaps you could talk about that.
Yes, I can say, I can give you an idea of what happened. So as we talked about it, we were one of the last families who left. And then when they reached, where would they have gone to Howrah, I guess, when they were landed in Howrah, my dad and a bunch of other people were taken to a jail called Kamarhati. And so dad continued to be in jail for another 6 months. And during that time, there was my mother, a single mother with three children, trying to establish herself. And Calcutta can be a difficult place, especially when they see a single woman. She had all sorts of barriers. She'd had some help from the family. But what I didn't learn till after the book was over was I was, as a child, I was terribly traumatized. I used to cry for my dad the whole time. And the city terrified me, you know, all the honking, because my home was Deoli. I wanted to go home, right? And in Calcutta, you'd hear these honking, and like it's a busy city, and it would freak me out. And then I got sick. And so mom had to deal with all these things. And the one thing she knew she had to do was get my my brothers back in school. And so she went to several schools. You know, there was sort of a distant family member who went with us and trying to introduce us to these schools. And they just said, do these boys know Bengali? And we're like, no, we don't study Bengali. Like we were up in the hills. We were in these, that wasn't a requirement in the schools that they were going to in Kalimpong. And so they rejected them. That was quite a few schools. And so she went to St. Xavier's and she had a change of thinking, and she just went ahead and told the fathers what her situation was. And so my brothers had to, you know, write a test, and based on that, they were accepted into St. Xavier's. So she was very grateful that people, there was some humanity, and that's, I think, where the humanity was. And then eventually dad got released, but he had a hard time. He had a lot of issues with not being able to go back, and he decided to fight it, which is even more difficult. But he was a very strong man, and he just decided he had the right to go home, right? And so he never did, but eventually we moved away from Calcutta and settled in Nepal. I would invite Swagato, and we talked about it, that Michael should probably say something. His journey was also like quite harrowing when he told me about it, and it's documented in the book. And then of course, if we have time, my brother.
Okay. Yeah. Can we bring Michael in? And we have a couple of questions from Tariq Thachil, which I think would cover some of these points as well. And perhaps Michael could tackle them. Okay, let me read out the questions. One point in the book was how a lot of the most acute difficulties internees faced occurred after they were released. Could you discuss how post-release experiences of trying to go back home? We've covered that a bit, but maybe Michael has his own angle on that. Two, can you talk a little more broadly about how you found subjects willing to speak about their experiences? No, that's, I guess, more directed at Joy and Dilip, because they wrote the book. But perhaps Joy and Dilip can talk about that after Michael.
Okay, Michael can unmute, yeah. Hey, Michael, can you unmute yourself?
Is Michael there still?
He is there. Early days in Zoom.
Yeah, Michael, can he come in?
Can we unmute him?
Yeah, maybe Alan can unmute.
I think he should now be able to unmute himself. Michael, if you try and unmute yourself, you should be able to do that now. He's been made a co-host.
Maybe he's not there.
Ah, there he is.
No, he's there. He's there. Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, Michael. I think he might have.
We're having difficulties. So maybe Joy and Dilip, you could talk about how you found subjects willing to talk about their experiences.
And you could actually connect it to, you could maybe connect it to Nafisa's question as well, which is, you know, how did the people you spoke with and interviewed remember the past? You know, was it based on memory and oral histories? Were there other sources, maybe records and letters that were saved by the community? So a little bit about like how you found the subjects and then how they, how their memories, you know, what shaped their memories. Thank you.
Sure.
You should take it. That's what I'm saying.
So for a long time, I thought about the story as my story, you know, because you can only tell your own story. But I had a hard time writing about it, you know, having to reveal myself to all my friends who actually, like, I hid that portion from, you know, most of my friends are from India. You know, I went to school till I was in college. It wasn't the most difficult thing to say, but it also didn't seem that I would be supported, but that's a different issue. So anyway, the point of that being that I found this, when I wrote an article for, the name of the publication. I wrote So I wrote for Outlook based on my friend asking me to write it. And it was mom's story about how she, the day she got interned, right? It was Chinese New Year on 25th on 1963. And so when that came out, I started getting connected with all these people and they said, you should go to Toronto. And I went to Toronto and I met everybody, including Michael and Andy and Yingsheng. And everybody was there. There were people who came to me that said, you know, I remember you as a baby. I used to hold you. And then somebody else came and said, I was born there. And so it took time to build a relationship, but it was like a community that I hadn't tapped into because everybody just keeps it to themselves, right? And so when I was ready to write the book, Dilip and I wrote a proposal and then I approached them. I had been talking to them for a long time and they were ready to talk. That we had finally arrived in the time. And I didn't realize the AIDCI had been the part of the reason of why they were ready to communicate this. And you know, they meet pretty regularly. They are lifelong friends. They talk about the camp often. It doesn't consume them, but what it did was make them available to tap into those memories. And part of writing the book was, you know, you get the information, then you have to go and research it, and you sort of make sure that it syncs up, right? And so one of the things, feedback I got from the book is some of it is so common. And I was thinking that's very similar. And my whole thing is that was by design. There was nothing to do in the camp. And what they're saying is the same, no matter where you go. So that's how I was able to, you know, talk to them. There were still a lot of people who do not want to be, reminded about the camp. I've gotten like locked out of relationships and people won't talk to me. So that is also continuing. It's not like everybody's rushing to tell me all their stories. But that was also a reason that we met Dilip in 2015 in India, excuse me. And Dilip knew the people enough, I think. Dilip, I'm speaking for you, but you went for that bus journey because I think some people were familiar.
And finally, Dilip, could you say something of the enabling legislation for confining Chinese Indians that was passed in 1962, the Defense of India Act and other legislations? And also, do you see echoes of that in the current CANRC legislations or promised legislations and actions, you know, which is roiling the country? It's led to a great deal of discontent in the in country in recent times.
Well, so, you know, in 1962, the government wanted to do this to the Chinese Indians, send them off to prison, but they wanted this sort of legal framework to do this. So they passed a number of laws. There was one that dated to soon after independence called the Defense of India Act or Ordinance. I can't remember. I can't remember whether it was an act. I need to go back and read the book, actually. But so they put in the language and then passed a number of other acts over those 3 or 4 months between, let's say, August of 1962 and maybe February of 1963, where they enabled this whole incarceration in different ways. And it just talked about, you know, the Foreigners Restriction Act. So certain areas were supposedly restricted to foreigners. And that was used against the Chinese Indians. Why they were considered foreigners is a question in itself. But that is the kind of thing that they used to incarcerate these people. You know, I think this also feeds into what Shastri said later, that they wanted to tell the world that we did this according to certain principles, you know, and it was not just a random thing that we did. And so they needed this legal framework, and really it was just a fig leaf. That's what it was. So all these laws enabled this, and it, in a sense, all of them really ask the question, who is a citizen of India? And how can you determine that? Who is a citizen, who is not? And you choose these guys to, you know, to do all these things to, and then effectively they're not citizens of India. And that's why I think there are parallels now with this attempt to pass the CAA, the Citizenship Amendment Act, and the NRC, because put together, they raise the same questions. And in fact, a few of my Chinese Indian friends, Joy included, see these parallels happening again in India, you know, that in different ways, we're questioning citizenship, and we're starting to find ways to deny the citizenship to certain people in certain ways, which is exactly what happened to the Chinese Indians. And that's why there's a parallel, and that's why I think we should learn from history. What we did to people then was in no ways defensible, if you ask me. And I think we're repeating, if we do pass the CAA and we go down that path, we're going to be repeating the same mistakes. And we're doing it in different ways too. We started building prison camps for people who will be detained under those CAA and NRC acts, which is exactly what we had a prison camp in 1962 where we sent these people. So we have prison camps again. I mean, why are we repeating this history? You know, for one thing, we don't even remember the history, and now we're repeating it. The whole thing seems so bizarre and twisted to me. And sorry, you know, it gets to me when I talk about it, and I just, you know, I get sort of heated about it. I'm sorry. But carry on.
Yeah, and Joy and so many other Chinese Indian families have had so much difficulty establishing the citizenship in India. It goes back again to that sort of distinction between civic notion of nationalism and citizenship, where anybody who adheres to a certain idea and declares his or her affiliation is a citizen, and against the ethnic notion where how people look or behave or the language they speak sort of determines their citizenship.
Or the faith they follow, Swagato.
The faith they follow. And you know, once again, the world is creating so many refugees. If you look at the Ukraine situation today, seem to be back at the same point almost as 1962. That's, I think, maybe another.
Wars do that, right? I mean, they create those kinds of situations.
I guess we are out of time. Thank you very much for this very moving compiling these very moving narratives into this book.
Can I show the book, by the way? And I do want to point out to those who haven't seen the book that is Joy's family on the cover. That's Joy's mother, Effa, who left us last year. Her older brother is Lyndon, right, Joy? Who also died of some years ago. And William, who's I think on the chat right now, is down there. And that, so there you are, Joy's family on the cover of our book. Before Joy,
I'll also just put the link. Yeah, I just put the link for everybody who might be interested. I'm not sure your preferred book vendor. I put the Amazon link. I wish there were independent bookstores I could put up there, but I'm just putting the easiest one for people to obtain the book. I recommend it very highly. It's a very compelling and quick read. We also have a link to the book on our events page on the CASI webpage. So first of all, let me also thank all three of you, Swagato, as well as Dilip and Joy, for having this really engaging conversation and taking us through really a forgotten period of our history, and one that needs to be remembered for many reasons, but including the fact, Dilip, as you were pointing out, that this is the 60-year anniversary of this internment experience. And so we should have kind of a commemoration of that as well. And so thank you so much for doing the hard work to bring these stories to light. And thank you, Swagato, so much for moderating the conversation. We look forward to having you at CASI soon.
Thank you.
Thank you for us. Yeah.
Yes, and apologies to not be able to have Michael share his experiences because of the connectivity, but thank you to him for joining us and joining this conversation especially.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.